Hello everyone, I am K. Navin Kumar of BZC first year. I am pursuing my bachelor's degree in BSc BZC at TTWRDC Mennagar Convent Jatchalla. And today I am here to give a live lecture on the type study of Schistosoma hematobium in the subject of zoology. And let us enter into our topic. And before entering into our topic, just I would like to show two images of Schistosoma hematobium right here. And why it is called as a Schistosoma actually. What is the meaning of schistosoma? And see here, schistos means in Greek, it is a word of Greek origin, and in Greek, schistos means divided, and soma means body. It possesses a divided body, hence it is called as schistosoma. And then after that, see this image right here, which is present on the right side. In this image, you can clearly observe the oral sucker right here, and you can clearly observe the acetabulum, and you can clearly observe the female schistosoma, and this is the male schistosoma, and the body surface of these schistosomes are rough and spiny. And see here, this is the gynecophoric canal in which this female is incorporated within the male. And as the caption is present, this is the image of male and female schistosomes. This is the image of male and female schistosomes respectively. Just observe the image which is present on the left side. See here you can clearly observe the images of male and female schistosomes right here. This is the female schistosome, and this is the male schistosoma. After these images, let us classify this schistosoma hematobium right here. Whenever we are dealing with the type study of any living organism, just first of all, we have to classify it, whether it belongs to which kingdom and phylum, class, order, family, genus and species like that. See here, it belongs to the kingdom of Animalia, where majority of the animals are present, and it belongs to the Platyhelminthes phyla. These members of these platyhelminthes are called as flatworms, and it belongs to the class Trematoda. Trematoda means they are whole bearing organisms, means they possess whorls in their body, and it belongs to the order Dicynia. And see here, just I want to say a few words about this class Trematoda. And in this class Trematoda, the members of this class are parasites actually. All the members of this class are parasites. They may be ectoparasitic or endoparasitic. And then see here, it belongs to the order Dicynia and family Schistosomidae, and genus is Schistosoma, and species is Hematobium. And then see here, in the species name, hema refers to blood. Schistosoma, it is called as blood fluke actually, and by that character, the name species name is given, that is Hematobium. After that, I would like to give some introduction points about this organism. See here, the old name of this schistosoma was Bilharzia, as it was discovered by a scientist called Bilharz. By the honor of him, it is called as Bilharzia. And in the year of 1851, he discovered this organism. And it is commonly known as blood fluke, as it lives in the blood vessels. And schistosomiasis is caused by the blood flukes from the genus Schistosoma. In this genus Schistosoma, majority of the organisms are blood flukes. They are blood flukes, and a disease called schistosomiasis is caused by these blood flukes, which belongs to the genus of Schistosoma. And then see here, more than 200 million people are infected worldwide by this disease, and this report was given by WHO, that is World Health Organization. And three main species infecting humans are Schistosoma hematobium and Schistosoma mansoni and Schistosoma japonicum. These are the three main species which majorly infect humans. And we would like to discuss about the Schistosoma hematobium, one of these three species. We would like to discuss in detail about Schistosoma hematobium. After that, just observe here, this species of Schistosoma right here, and these are the types of schistosomes. See here, this is the image of Schistosoma mansoni, and this is the image of Schistosoma japonicum, and this is the image of Schistosoma hematobium, about which we would like to discuss now. And these are main types of schistosome. They affect humans. They are pathogen to humans. And then see here, whenever we are dealing with the type study of any living organism, just after the classification, before going to the detailed study of that organism, just we have to know the habitat and geographical distribution of that particular living organism. And like that, I too discuss about the habitat and geographical distribution of this Schistosoma hematobium right here. And what is meant by habitat actually? Habitat means the place where the living organism lives. What is the habitat of us? Habitat. What is the habitat of human beings? We are living on the earth, and particularly we are living on in our houses. That means these are the habitat of human beings. And then see here, what is the habitat of these Schistosoma right here? And adult these Schistosoma, when in the form of adult worms, are found in the human hepatic portal or pelvic venous plexus. They are found in the human hepatic portal or pelvic venous plexus and vesical prostatic and uterine plexuses of veins. They are present in these habitats when they are in the form of adult worms. And this is about the habitat of these Schistosoma hematobium right here. And after that, just I would like to discuss about the geographical distribution of this Schistosoma hematobium. And what is meant by geographical distribution actually? Geo means earth. That means the range of places occupied by these living organisms around the earth. See here, the Schistosoma hematobium is endemic. It is endemic in nature and found in the various parts of Africa, Western Asia, and South Europe, and in India also it is present. In India also, in our country also it is present. And then see here, just after that habitat and geographical distribution, just I would like to discuss about the morphology of these Schistosoma hematobium right here. And see here, Schistosoma is dioecious. Dioecious means sexes are separate, and it is with the well-defined sexual dimorphism. Means both the sexes are separate, and male and female organisms are separate. That means the sex is separate for male and female organisms. Means a single organism possesses, it may be male or female, and both the sexes are won't present in a single organism. And see here, it is peculiar, means it is different in having the separate males and females. It different in having the separate males and females in these flat elementis, that is trematodes. And but the two are found in pairs, means they are in pairs, means the female is incorporated within the male. And then see here, ethnic male is permanently carries a slender but longer female within it. And see here, the female schistosome is generally it is longer than the male, and it is slender than the male. That is, it is thinner than the male, and it is longer than the male, and it is carried in a canal called gynecophoric canal. And this canal called gynecophoric canal, which is formed by the folding of the ventral body wall of male schistosoma. It is formed by the folding of the ventral body wall of male schistosoma. And then see here, the body surface is rough and spiny. How the body surface is? That is a rough and spiny, as I told you earlier. And then see here, both have an oral sucker and an acetabulum. Both having oral sucker along with the acetabulum. They possess oral sucker and acetabulum, which is also called as ventral sucker. And there is no pharynx. They won't possess pharynx. And then see here, the two intestinal limbs, they become united into one at the posterior end of the body. At the posterior end of the body, the two intestinal limbs, they become united to form single limb. That is at the posterior end of this body. After that, see here, another image of which indicates about the morphology of this schistosoma hematobium. See here, you can clearly observe the male schistosoma, which is indicated in the light pinkish color, and the female schistosoma is in the color is in the red color. And see here, first of all, we would like to discuss about the male schistosoma. And here you can clearly observe the oral sucker of male schistosoma, and this is the acetabulum of male schistosoma, and this is the esophagus of male schistosoma. And see here, this is the gynecophoric canal. This is the gynecophoric canal of male schistosoma, and this is the place of fusion of crura right here. And see here, this body surface of these male schistosoma is rough and spiny, as I told you earlier. And after this male schistosoma, just I would like to discuss about the female schistosoma right here. And see this and here you can clearly observe, and this is the intestine of male process both have an oral sacs from the testis each test seminal vesicle it sex organ that is a penis opens by gonopore, a pore called gonopore below the acetabulum which is acetabulum that is ventral sucker and this female schistosoma has an elongated ovary that means here this ovary is above the point where inter rejoins and these ovaries are rejoins means they are again they are combining and from the ovary a oviduct process from this ovary a duct called oviduct process in front of this ovary a oviduct is arising and in the posterior of the posterior third of the female the vitelline glands some more glands called vitelline glands are also present from which a vitelline duct from these glands a duct called vitelline duct these ducts they will combine they will unite and they will join and this oviduct meets O type surrounded by a Mehl's gland this O type is surrounded by these glands called Mehl's glands and this oviduct meets the O type and from the O type arises a straight uterus from this O type uterus arises in straight manner and it opens the uterus opens by a female gonopore which is situated below the acetabulum this female gonopore is again situated this is also situated below the acetabulum like that of male and then see here after this slide just I would like to discuss about the life cycle of schistosoma hematobium right here and schistosoma hematobium is a dizygenic in nature that means what it includes two hosts that is primary host and intermediate host it involves as I told you earlier it involves two hosts that is or else we can also call this primary host as a definitive host and the definitive host of this schistosoma is man human and the intermediate host that is secondary host of this schistosoma is freshwater snails and some of the species of these freshwater snails are Bulinus trunctatus and other species throughout Africa and these Bulinus trunctatus and some of the other species are in the region of Africa and Planorbarius metidensis and these are countries of Morocco and Portugal and another species called Ferisa tenias which are present in our country that is India and then these are the intermediate hosts of humans these are the intermediate hosts of schistosomes and then these are the life cycle stages of schistosoma hematobium right here see here the first stage is egg after that it will be converted into meristem then it is converted into sporocyst stage where asexual reproduction that means binary fission may occur, and after that cerium may be formed, and this will be converted into adult worms like this. And about these life stages of schistosoma hematobium, we would like to discuss in detail after this later on. See here, this is about the and intermediate host, or else they may also called as primary host and secondary host. See here, the definitive hosts are organisms that support the sexual reproductive forms of parasites. In this definitive host, the sexual reproduction of these parasites will occur, and they are also called as primary host, as I told you earlier. And the sexual reproduction of the parasitic forms occurs here, as I discussed earlier. And see here, the formation of zygotes occur right here in this definitive host. And examples for these definitive hosts are, the definitive host of Plasmodium is female Anopheles. For the parasite called Plasmodium, the definitive host is female Anopheles. And the intermediate hosts are the organisms that supports the immature or non-reproductive forms of parasites. And they are also called as secondary hosts. As I told you earlier. And the sexual reproduction of the parasites may occur right here in this intermediate host. And then see here, the sexual differentiation of parasitic forms occurs right here. The sexual differentiation may occur in this intermediate host. And then see here, the intermediate host of Plasmodium is human. The intermediate of Plasmodium parasite is man. In case of Schistosoma hematobium, the intermediate host is the freshwater snail, and the definitive host is human beings. And this is about the difference in between the definitive host and intermediate host. And after that, just I would like to discuss about the post-fertilization events in this Schistosoma hematobium right here. And see here, after the fertilization, the female leaves the male to lay eggs. And these are both male and female organisms, they occur in pairs up to the fertilization event. And after this fertilization event, this male in this male, the female is not present, and this female schistosoma that leaves the gynecophoric canal of male schistosoma to lay eggs one at a time in the smaller blood vessels, where it lays eggs in the smaller blood vessels. The embryonated eggs are passed with the urine of the definitive host, that is man. These embryonated eggs of these schistosoma are passed with the urine of definitive host, that is human, and gain the access to water. These embryonated, they gain the access to water, and ciliated larva, the miracidium hatched out of the eggs. These are the ciliated larva, and they move freely in the water in search for their intermediate host, freshwater snail. These free moving larvae, that is Miracidium, are in search for their intermediate host, that is a freshwater snail. And the life cycle of these Schistosoma hematobium will be like this. See here, the embryonated egg is released right here. See here, this is the embryonated egg, and then Myristicum is produced. After that, sporocyst is produced. After this sporocyst, it will be converted into sarcarium. And this sarcarium, which is infective to humans, and it enters the skin by penetrating it. And after that, it will be converted into adult worm, and the life cycle is thus repeated. And after this, just see the life stages of the these schistosoma right here. And these life stages are just first of all, I would like to discuss about the Myristicum larvae, and as I told you earlier, this Myristicum larva is a free swimming, freely moving ciliated larva. That means they possess cilia, and it is a minute, means small, oval, elongated. It is also elongated and free swimming ciliated stage of Schistosoma hematobium. Broader anterior end. See here in this image of Schistosoma, the anterior end is broader, that means widened anterior end, and produced into apical papillae. Here you can also observe the apical papillae, and in this region of apical papillae, a pair of penetration glands opened by their narrow ends in this near the region of this apical papillae in the anterior end. And then see here, within the body of Myristicum are present glands and protonephridia, nervous tissue and germ cells. And Myristicum does not feed, and it settles in the mollusk, that is a snail. And it won't feed, that means it won't intake food, and it will be converted into sporocyst within the snail, within this intermediate host, that is snail. And then see here, the Myristicum on entering the its proper larval host, it penetrates into the soft tissues of the snail, and ultimately makes its way into liver right here. After this entering of host is life stage specific. That means the Myristicum has to enter this intermediate host only, and it won't directly enter into definitive host. Like that, this Myristicum on entering this intermediate host, it will be converted into sporocyst stage, and then it will be making its path to reach the liver, and here it encloses its cilia. It loses its cilia, and some other organs along with cilia, it also loses some other organs. And in the course of 4 to 8 weeks, that means 1 month to 2 months, it undergoes some developmental changes, and the Myristicum is transformed into a tubular sporocyst. After these developmental changes, it will be converted into tubular sporocyst. How the sporocyst looks like? It will be in the form of tubular sporocyst. Tubular means it is in the shape of a tube. And the first generation of sporocyst may again produce the Myristicum. And this first generation of sporocyst may again lead to the production of Myristicum larvae. This is about the structure of Myristicum larvae, and some of the description of Myristicum larvae. So the description and diagram of sporocyst larvae right here. and this porocyst is an elongated and germinal sac. It is elongated. See here, it is elongated in structure and it possesses it is a germinal sac which is covered with a thin cuticle. It is covered with a thin cuticle right here, and you can observe right here, and the glands and apical papilla of Meracidium will disappear. As I told you earlier, the Meracidium larvae, it loses cilia of the organism, organs like apical papillae and some of the glands, and it will become sporocyst. See here, the hollow interior space of sporocyst has a pair of protonephridia with flame cells. The protonephridia, they possess flame cells, and it has germ cells described as a germinal sac earlier, and then the sporocyst moves about the host tissues. It moves about in the host tissues, and its germ cells develop into the second generation of sporocyst, and as it is moving within the host tissues, the germ cells may develop into the second generation of sporocysts. And several weeks after the infection, when no further multiplication occurs, the daughter sporocysts gives rise to the third type of larvae called Sarcaria. And when no further division takes place, what happens, these daughter sporocysts may give rise to the third type of larva called Sarcaria. This is the third type of larva and third type of life stage of this schistosoma hematobium. And these schistosomes are a single exception among these the digenetic trematodes. In these digenetic trematodes, these are the schistosomes are the single exceptions where radia are not produced. Radia are another type of larva, and these are not produced in these digenetic trematodes, that is a schistosoma hematobium. In this organism, the radia larva are not produced, and asexual multiplication taking place only in this sporocyst stage only in this stage of sporocyst. After that, see the structure and some of the description along with the diagram of Sarcaria larva right here, which is the third stage of larva in the schistosoma hematobium life cycle. Morphologically, the Sarcaria bears a close resemblance. It bears a close resemblance. That means it is similar to the adult fluke. And it is an oval body. It is oval shaped with long focal tails. Means long tails. You can also observe right here. Forked tails means it is divided. That means it is forked tails. And first being swimming. That means what? If tails are present, they are helpful in the swimming of this Sarcaria. And it has rudiments of organs of an adult. These have the rudiments of organs for the adult. And there are two suckers, the oral sucker and ventral sucker. In this Sarcaria larva, you can observe the oral sucker and ventral sucker. And along with these suckers, you can also observe the alimentary canal. There is an excretory tubules along with these organs with a number of flame cells, which are called, which are the photonephridia. And then there are large penetration glands. In this Sarcaria larva, these penetration glands are present, and they has the rudiments of reproductive organs, rudimentary reproductive organs formed from the germ cells. These rudiments of reproductive organs are formed from the germ cells, and the sarcaria break off from the sporocyst and escape from the snail into water. And these sarcaria, which are produced by the sporocyst stage, they will break off from the sporocyst stage, and they are escaping from these intermediate host, that is a snail, into the water. They enter into the water, and which are very infective, and they are pathogens to the humans. And infection results when human beings are bathing or wading in this water, infected water, where sarcaria larva are present. And the sarcaria are penetrating unbroken skin directly. The sarcaria penetrating the unbroken skin where damage is not occurred. Means there is no slit, and in that place also it can easily penetrate into the skin of the definitive host, that is humans. And on entry, these sarcaria cast off their tails, not known as a schistosome, now known as a schistosome. Means they remove their tails in this sarcaria stage when it is in the definition. They are now known as schistosomes after casting their tails, and gain access to peripheral venule. They gain access to peripheral venules, and from here they are carried to the right heart. They are carried into the right heart through these peripheral venules, and again, they are also carried into the pulmonary capillaries, which are present in the lungs. And it requires some days for the larva to pass through the capillary bed, which is present in the lungs. That means it takes some time to. To pass these larvae through these capillary bed in these lungs. And after that, some more detail about larva. When they are carried through the left heart, when they are reached the left heart into the systemic circulation, the oxygenated blood is supplied to the all parts of the body through this systemic circulation, and majority are shunted on the abdominal aorta and gain access to the mesenteric artery. They gain access into the mesenteric artery by shunting on the abdominal aorta. That means they are situated on the abdominal right aorta, and they gain access to the mesenteric artery, and they pass through the capillary bed in the intestine. They pass through the capillary bed situated in the intestine, and then enter the portal circulation, which connects the intestine with the liver, and then it takes 5 days to reach the liver from this intestine for this larval stage. And then in the intrahepatic, means within the liver, in the intrahepatic portion of the portal bloodstream, the larva grow into adults. They are matured into adults, maturing in 3 weeks from the time of entry. It means what? From the time of infection, from the time of penetrating into the skin, it takes 3 weeks to mature into the adult. And the sarcaria are developing from the one egg will produce flukes. That means what? they are dioecious. That means the egg, from one egg they will produce one fluke of only one sex. That may be male or female. And females do not mature in a harsh well, no males are present. Means without males there is no maturity of females. When these males and females are occur in pairs, the maturity of female will takes place. And then see here, when a male finds a female, they enters her in a gynecophoric canal, and it takes about 3 months for the worms to reach the vesical and pelvic plexus. And these are, as I told you earlier, these are the habitat of these adult worm stages of schistosomes. They are vesical and pelvic plexuses of veins. After the initial exposure of the skin, when the worms are sexually matured, they copulate with each other, and the fertilized females may lay eggs, as I told you earlier, they will lay eggs by leaving the gynecophoric canal of male, which are ultimately voided with the urine. They are passed along with the urine, and then the life cycle will thus repeated by this laying eggs and copulation, and then this life cycle will be repeated again and again. And then see here, just I would like to discuss about the life cycle of Schistosoma hematobium, and this image is collected from the CDC, that is Center for Disease Control. And it is in this image, see here, in the first stage, what happens, the eggs shed from infected humans, the humans Schistosoma hematobium, in them these eggs are produced. That means sexual reproduction of these Schistosoma hematobium occurs, which leads to the fertilization of female. Then these female will again releases, this female will again releases embryonated eggs, and these eggs will shed off with the urine of these infected humans. And see here, this is the egg, egg released by the Schistosoma hematobium, which is right here. And then it will be passed along with the urine, and then it is hatched. It will be hatched, the hatching the free swimming ciliated freely moving larva, that is Miraceria. And then this Miraceria larva, which reaches the its intermediate host, that is a freshwater snail, and after reaching this freshwater snail, it will be converted into sporocyst stage, and the sporocyst develop in snail successive generations, along with the successive generations, that may be second generation or third generation. And see here, in the fifth stage, what you can observe right here, here, Sarcaria are released from the snail into water. After that, sporocyst stage in the snail, and that will be converted into this Sarcarian stage. And this is the infective stage. In this scale right here, you can clearly observe that this is the image for infective stages. And see here, this is the infective stage for humans. And the Sarcaria, they penetrates the skin of humans, and they reaches the hepatic portal system, and they reaches by reaching the left part of heart, and by there they are carried to the systemic circulation. From there they are carried again to the portal system of these humans. And then their sexual reproduction may occur. From there, they are carried out. Eggs are carried out through the urine of these humans. And in this sixth stage, the penetration will occur. And after that, see the seventh stage right here. Sargeria lost their tails during the penetration and become schistosomulae. What happens? These Sargeria on penetration of human skin, what happens? They loses their tails and they became as schistosomulae. By the circulatory system of human, they migrates to portal blood in liver. Maturation into adults takes place. After that, it will mature into adults. And see here, this is the symbol of female schistosoma and this is the male schistosoma right here. This is the male and this is the image of female schistosoma, which are occur in pairs. And paired adult worms are migrated to mesenteric venules. They are migrated to mesenteric venules of ball or rectum, laying eggs that circulate liver and shed into stools, that means fecal matter of human beings. And in case of these schistosoma hematobium species, especially they are migrated to venous plexus of bladder, urinary bladder, and eggs are shed in urine. The eggs are shed in the urine and they are passed along with the urine, and then the life cycle will be continued again and again like this. This is about the life cycle of schistosoma hematobia and the infective stages and diagnostic stages are indicated in by these symbols right here. And this is the diagnostic stage. That means what? At this stage we can diagnose that disease, means we can find that disease. And this is the infective stage of humans. After this life cycle, see here pathogenicity of these schistosoma hematobium right here. And as the disease is caused by the infection with schistosoma hematobium is referred to as schistosomiasis hematobia, as I told you earlier. And then infection of schistosoma causes various symptoms like allergy, and it may also cause itch and itches and rashes, aches means pains, and it may also cause fever and eosinophilia. And see here, when infection is heavy, eggs may be deposited in arterioles of lungs. It may cause another symptom called cardiopulmonary schistosomiasis. This is another case when these heavy eggs are deposited within the arterioles of lungs. It will lead to the another condition called cardiopulmonary schistosomiasis, which may be leads to the congestive heart failure, which may blocks these arterioles, and that leads to the congestive heart failure, that is CHF. And then see here, schistosoma causes bladder stones. It may causes bladder injury and bladder stones and skin diseases and hematuria, which is a disorder of kidneys. This hematuria, which is the disorder of kidneys with the discharge of blood within the urine. And then see here, after that, just I would like to discuss about the diagnosis of schistosoma right here. And this is based on the demonstration of eggs of schistosoma hematobium. See here, in this diagnosis methods, we have mainly three methods right here, and this is this diagnosis is based on majorly by finding the eggs of this schistosoma hematobium, as I explained to you earlier in the life cycle of schistosoma hematobium. In the first step, first method, see here, a microscopical examination of urine may help us to the diagnosis of this schistosoma hematobium, and that is a diagnostic method for schistosomiasis. And then see here, examination of stool may also, that may be another method of diagnostic method of this schistosomiasis. And after that, in the third method, what we can see here, a piece of vesical mucosa is removed by a cytoscopic biopsy. Cytoscopic biopsy. A piece of vesical mucosa may be removed to and then it is tested. It is tested for those eggs laid by that female schistosoma hematobium, and then it is carried out through the cytoscopic. Cyto means cells, cell. That means it is the examination of cells, and by the process of biopsy. What is meant by biopsy? Biopsy, it is a process. It is a process by which a part of our body sample is taken, and it is examined to diagnose any disease, and that is the biopsy. And then see the treatment methods for these schistosomiasis hematobia. And then the drugs having specific actions on the schistosomes are praziquantel and metrifornate. These are the drugs, they have specific actions on these schistosomes, and praziquantel is a more effective drug than these metrifornate drug. And then see here, schistosomiasis is treated with antimony drugs. It may also be treated with antimony drugs such as tartar emetic, fodin, and anthiomalin. These are the antimony drugs which are also helpful in the treatment of schistosomiasis hematobia. And then after the treatment methods of these hematobia, the prophylaxis of these schistosomiasis hematobia is given right here. And prophylaxis means what? The preventive measures. These are the preventive measures. They are see here in this first are wading or washing in this infected water. Avoid swimming and bathing and wading, washing in this infected water of schistosoma. And prevention of pollution of water with human excreta. That means by preventing the pollution of water with human excreta, you can also prevent this schistosomiasis hematobia. And the destruction of snail vector, that is the intermediate host for these endemic areas. In these endemic areas like Africa regions, and Western Asia regions and Indian regions. And then see here, the eradication of the disease in man. By the eradication of this disease also, the life cycle of these schistosoma will be stopped. And then it may be a prophylaxis measure for these schistosoma hematobia. And then after that, fifth prophylaxis method is the diseases can be prevented by the sanitary control of water. They can be cured by the compounds of antimony. As I told you earlier in the treatment methods, they may be cured by the compounds of antimony. And then see here, In this slide, just I would like to say that the prevention is better than cure. That means when we are infected with this schistosomiasis hematobium, we will, and that may be a complex thing. And after curing, in the case of curing, see here what are the things we have to know. And it is a complex thing, and it is very expensive, and it is very time consuming thing, and it may be stress on family. That means whether the patient may be cured or not, that may become a stress to the family. And things about the prevention. It is very easy method, and it is, in this preventive method, very negligible cost is present, and it is not expensive, and it is a very healthy life and a happy family. It may also leads to the happy family. And this is the image I would like to show you, which makes difference in between prevention and cure. The final statement is that prevention is better than cure, as many doctors said. Don't infected with these schistosomes, and abide the rules that makes far away from these schistosomes. That means take the prophylaxis methods. That means preventive methods for these schistosomes, and prevent these diseases, and eradicate these diseases from human beings. And this is about today's presentation by K. Navin Kumar of BZC first year. And thank you one and all. And I would like to thank our principal sir, K.P. Nirikshana Rao sir, and vice principal madam, Vice Neha madam. And I would like to thank Department of Zoology Dr. Manjula madam and Rajesh Kumar sir, Raj Kumar sir, for encouraging me to do such a live lecture on this schistosoma type study. And this is about today's session. Thank you one and all, and thank you for giving me such an opportunity to present this live lecture during this corona pandemic. And stay safe, stay home, and wear mask. And once again, thank you one and all.